Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Order for June 20th, 2016. And would please join me in prayer. Most gracious, we heavenly Father, thank you so much for all the blessings you give us. Thank you for the opportunity to openly discuss government with each other and talk about what the needs of our county are. God, just be with us tonight as we go through this budget hearing. Help us to make the right decisions. And God, be with the men that are overseas that are fighting tonight for our safety so that we can do this, our freedoms. Thank you for all the law enforcement that have to go out every night, every day, and protect us. These things we ask in thy name. Amen. Let's say the pledge.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, our first order of business is for the approval of the agenda. Any additions, deletions?
Mr. Chair, if I could, we need to add a public hearing to be scheduled for CS Carolina for an economic incentive request for our July 18th meeting.
And we can do that at the end?
Anywhere, right? We'll make sure that after that at all.
Okay. How about after our budget discussion?
That's fine.
July 18th. Anything else, anyone? All right, then I'll entertain a motion to approve. Bob, thank you. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, our next order of business tonight is the budget public hearing. And on our agenda, we have put 3 minutes, but for sake of everybody having a chance to speak, we're going to allow 5 minutes. However, we do have a timer that we will be using, and hopefully everybody can keep within the 5 minutes. So with that,
we'd like to show you where we're at right now with respect to the budget after our meeting on public hearing.
That would be a great idea, and let's just see where we are and go from there.
Again, thank you, Mr. Chairman, Board of Commissioners, and let me thank you for the work that y'all have done on this budget. We have put a lot of time and a lot of effort. I want to thank you. I want to thank our finance staff. I want to thank our department heads. It really is a budget that does touch a lot of different areas and hopefully moves us forward in the right direction. Not going to go through the full slide presentation as I did a couple weeks ago when managers recommended. Not a lot has changed, but what has, let's see what we get. Is what we did at our meeting on June 16th. And the discussion really centered around at our June 16th meeting was additional funding for ABSS. So the discussion and what we have added to the budget is we have looked to increase the current expense to ABSS by $1,050,000. That is $800,000 in new revenue, and we have moved $250,000 from capital to current expense. So instead of $500,000 for capital for ABSS, it would be $250,000. So that would be an increase of $1,050,000. Again, transfer capital outlay to current expense. Also, we've reduced the purchase of two cars from the sheriff, and I really do appreciate the sheriff doing this. Sheriff recently received his drug forfeiture money back, and the sheriff was willing to buy four cars out of this budget year with drug forfeiture money, so he was willing to cut two cars moving forward. So I do appreciate the sheriff on that. So if we look at what we did as far as reductions and additions, With $738,340 in addition to the budget that was presented to you 2 weeks ago. And here's how we paid for it. We looked at our sales tax, and I hope y'all got the email that we got a couple of days ago talking about our April sales tax figures, April 15 versus April 16. And it was a $400,000 increase. So in working with our finance department, we did feel like we could go up another percent on sales tax as we were budgeting fairly conservative with sales tax. So that was another $238,824. That leaves us approximately $500,000 from fund balance to get to the $738,340. And what we discussed at the workshop last Thursday is that we either use fund balance or, this is all fund balance. Let me make this perfectly clear. Performance money is part of fund balance. Unassigned is part of fund balance. So this is all fund balance, regardless of what pot we take it from. It is all fund balance.
Designated.
Well, it's designated for the performance. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. With the designated would be approximately 1.5 for the performance phase. And then we have 1.1 million to be distributed from 14-15, and all departments carried a $404,000 balance in their line item. So we have the option of using that money. We have the option of using a percentage of one versus undesignated. We can use it all. That's the options that we came up with. Any questions?
Well, just to be clear, that the increase in the projected sales tax revenue is still a very conservative projection. We're still exercising that accounting principle to project revenue.
We're still being very, very conservative with our projections. That's one reason our fund balance has grown so much. We're being very conservative. And but we felt comfortable in looking at the trends of being able to go up another percent on sales tax revenue, especially with that $400,000 increase from April 15 to 16. Yes, sir. Again, thank you, and again, I want to thank Susan and Andrea. I appreciate your input, and thank you for your hard work in getting us to this point.
All right. And I think you need to notice we're staying at the 58 cents.
We are staying, yes,
sir.
So
you didn't mention that anywhere.
Our tax rate will remain at 58 cents for 100 valuation.
Seen when I walked through the ABSS schools was the most vibrant students, the most hopeful teachers. Of course, they was tired and gassed out that day. But they were at a place where the walls was pretty dingy, the roof was leaky, the floors were wrinkled, which it looked pathetic, to be honest with you. It looked pathetic. And I understand that Orange County and Guilford County both have to pay their teachers. But in order for us to stay competitive, we also have to pay our teachers more. And it's not Alamance County fault. It's not y'all fault. It's essentially the General Assembly. We know that. But an economic incentive or economic plan or economic investment, the most important economic investment is in education. There is no doubt about that. There's no way that you all get where y'all at without education. there's no way I get where I'm at without the education I went to Commons High School. So I went to ABSS. There's no way that anyone is in this audience gets where they are without education. But there is a place that you can get without education, which is not a place where any of us wants to be. So the idea of somehow cutting a penny or a dime out of education and not giving the ABSS exactly what they want is actually, again, shortchanging our future. Last year, Alamance County, and thank you all, you made a serious commitment to education, which was great. And again, this year, we actually need more. We need to make sure that ABSS has every penny that they need. Not the idea, can you work with this? We all can work with whatever we get. A lot of people survive, not many people live, so we all work with what we can get. But we all need education. We need the bus system. We need the education system. And we need it to the point where no matter what Orange County or Gifford County or Forsyth County does or Wake County does, that Alamance, Alamance County has undoubtedly the most vigorous or the most futuristic, the most comfortable environment that any teacher could teach in. Now, we can't match them penny for penny or dime for dime, nickel for nickel, and that's ridiculous to think that we could. Of course, we have way too many conservatives in this county that even try to push that. But what we do need to do is we need to make sure that we are competitive. We do pay the rate that we need to pay our teachers. We do need to make sure that by the time they get to ACC Community College or the community college here, that they're able to have, they're able to go straight to the STEM economics of the day, or go out straight out to work. We know that the higher education you get, the better education you get, that your wages go up. We know that you're more likely to be employed. We know that you're more likely to be more successful, less violent crimes. We can go on and on and on and on. And I honestly believe that education is the economic driver, not just pay. So if ABSS asks for whatever they need, I just hope that y'all say, hey, there's other places that we can do without, but what we cannot do without is education. And if we do go a penny out and shortchange one student, one penny, then we're gonna have to ask, the sheriff will be here next year asking for another car because we'll be arresting them. So thank you all, and have a great night.
All right, anybody else want to talk about
Flash Frightenberry, and I live in the county. And, you know, I've spoke about this before. I've got friends on the school board that I consider good friends. I've got people on county commissions that I consider good friends. I do not go along with what you're doing to our sheriff. Mr. Bird, Ms. Masson, Judge, Roger, you guys don't have to worry about it. You've got city police. Without public safety, young man, you can't have schools. I'm all for giving teachers a pay raise. I have one in each profession. I have a daughter that's a school teacher. I have a son that's a deputy. As a dad, you don't think I worry about him every day when he walks out the door and gets in the car? He's out here protecting you. Terry Johnson doesn't need two cars. on deputies. He can pay for the cars. But if you guys can give the teachers a pay raise, it's all about giving teachers a pay raise. It's all about the schools. You can't have school without public safety. This man has taken a mediocre sheriff's department about 12 years ago and made one of the best in the state, if not the nation. He's been cut back from 5 to 2 deputies, Mr. Manager. I'm asking you tonight to restore that. Give the sheriff what he needs to protect the schools, to protect Alamance County. The city of Burlington has 70 or 72 sworn officers patrolling the streets of Burlington. This man's got 40 deputies patrolling the county. At any given time, a deputy gets in trouble, it may be 15 minutes before another deputy can get to him. I'm asking for the safety of the schools, for the safety of Alamance County citizens. Quit taking things away from him and cutting his budget and this performance money. I want to salute the county employees because they work hard to save that money. I think maybe the school system, maybe they need to work on some performance and save some money. Go down to Eastern Alamance and look at the press box down there. That's a different thing. I'm asking you tonight to support our sheriff like you do the schools. I want to be safe. I want my child to be safe. I want these deputies that are in here tonight to be safe. We've got to have a safe county. And unless you give Terry Johnson the deputies to work with, we can't be safe. And God willing, if my health holds up, I'll be on the ballot for the next board. God bless you, and I hope y'all will take note and stand up and give this man what he needs. Don't give him 2 deputies. Give him 5. He needs 20.
research shows us that a high-quality public education system is the long-term answer to lowering our county's crime rates and to creating a healthier, more economically vibrant community. And that's exactly why education is a key priority in the county health assessment. So I'd like to point out a few statistics in the assessment, if you've not all had a chance to see that, that show why education has been listed as that priority. Our educational attainment levels in Alamance County and our average weekly wage are well below the state average. Research shows, and I've said this many times in front of you, that the higher quality of an education one receives and the higher level of educational attainment one achieves, that the better physical, mental, and economic health outcomes they'll have as adults. And our own county's data proves that point. 15% of our community's residents have bachelor's degrees. 15%, again, below the state average. Their unemployment rate is 3.4%, and their yearly wage is about $45,000. So contrast that with the 17% of our folks who have not gotten a high school diploma. So we have 17% who haven't graduated from high school. Their unemployment rate is over 11%, and their wages are below the poverty line. So there's a direct correlation between education and income, which is what we've been saying time and time again. And that 17% is very close to the overall county poverty line for adults of 18.9%. So again, there's a direct correlation. So a lot of times people ask, why does this happen? So I'd encourage you to look at our county as a power grid. And in some parts of the community, that grid is really, really strong. And parents and families and children have the opportunity to plug in and to charge up their learning and to have access to the resources and supports that they need to be successful. And in other parts of the county, both rural and urban, the grid's really spotty. And families don't have the opportunity to plug into what they need to be successful. So in the areas of our community where resources are spotty, it's more important than ever to have excellent schools with skilled educators and strong leadership. Schools become the key place for children and families to plug into the resources that they need to build strong social, emotional, and academic skills. Those three things are what children need to be successful. Social, emotional, and academic. That's how kids learn. And you can look at it like building a rope. Each thing on its own is really important. And if you have strong areas in all three and you weave it together, you're going to have a strong growth. So that's what children need to be successful in life. So if all of our kids, regardless of their zip code, have the opportunity to plug in and to build strong skills throughout our county, they're much more likely to be successful in life and to be strong contributing future members of our community. You all are the architects of our county. You may not see yourselves in that role, but you are. You are shaping our future, and you hold the keys to the community's future. So I'd like you to think beyond this budget, an annual budget, and really think what you want this county to look like in 10 to 15 years. If you want lower crime, if you want better jobs, if you want a higher tax base, you need to make investments that are going to ensure that strong grid throughout the entire county. And that takes all of the departments in the county, the Sheriff's Department, Social Services, the Health Department, and education. And of course, it's my thought that education should be at the top of the priority list. So I thank you for what you've done to support the schools, but I ask you to please consider funding the full request of the school system so that we can continue to move forward toward the world-class education that this county envisions and deserves. Thank you.
Anyone else on this side?
As we all know, it's not just y'all that is a part of instructing we the people. It's everybody. Everybody that y'all give money to. Sheriff, schools, maintenance, manager, attorneys. Everybody. But when there's a breakdown of the system, getting over it. Coming here tonight, walking up here, I was hearing the deputy But in this county, people like to say, villainize different people. You'll never be able to make it. You'll never be able to make it. But those people make it. An example of it is me. Mr. Smith, you've known me for what, 10 years now? Accusation after accusation after accusation. I'm still tall, never mind. They said, we can all smile at that. I told Mr. Smith years ago, I said, Mr. Smith, I told the Board of Commissioners, one of these days I want to show y'all. And I do it meeting after meeting after meeting. But if it makes people feel good to go on that as me, but y'all know the truth.
Sheriff Terry Johnson knows the truth, I'm sure.
Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. But I know the paper show. We got the proof. At the Alamance County Planning Board meeting, 3-4 last week. And I want to make this clear. I want to take my name off of. I stood with those people out there, the citizens out there, no, the people out there, at Ace Speedway. I can feel the pain out there. But because of the wording that was used at that last planning board meeting, I don't want to be on that part of another. I don't stay on the people. Because I believe that the wording, when that man gets stood up at that microphone and said, if the sheriff won't help us and the county won't help us, we'll do what we need to do, and when the sheriff pulls up, he'll know what it's about. Does it bother you, Murray? I stand by everybody in this government. How many times have I told y'all since you've been elected again and you've been elected, that I love you? Time and time again. There ain't a person in this room, if they need my help, I'd help. Period. But, and I stand by that. I stand by those newspaper articles. I'm not one of them. My heart's pure. I don't care if they do it to themselves. They do it to themselves. There's a breakdown. I didn't do it. I don't know where we're at. But I still love y'all. And y'all did the right thing.
Anybody on this side? Anybody else? We're going to move over on this side and we'll start in front. I think we have you on as a special speaker.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that.
You can come on and speak if you'd like, sir.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm Pat Dodowska, the District Attorney of Alamance County. I just want to thank the County Commissioners for funding our jail prosecutor position. Last fiscal year, this is using very conservative estimates through those measurement principles. We saved $483,000, so that's close to $500,000. So it's been a very good collaborative effort between us and the county. And it's something that I appreciate because it does help the county, certainly with the jail and the jail issues that we have, but it also helps the district attorney's office because it gives us the ability to more effectively combat cases that we can try in court. So I thank you.
All right. Going up this way. Are there any more speakers from this side? A lot of lunch tonight. Everybody good? Conference clear. is here with Foster. If you'll come forward and just kind of tell us what you're working on and where you come up with the numbers and go from there.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. Asking for an increase from 9.25 cents to 11 cents this budget year. That will generate an estimate of $73,870 in our revenue. Our last tax increase was in 2012, and it was only for 0.5 cents. Some of the reasons for asking for the increase this year is we purchased a new engine that's supposed to be here sometime in March 2017, and this will cost approximately $569,000. Hopefully, within the next 2 years, we can put some money down and make a sufficient down payment, and then finance maybe $400,000 for the next 10 years. That's one of them. Another reason is replacement of the turnout gear. All our turnout gear is made on, and we've got everything within the 10-year mark. NFPA says that you cannot have turnout gear that's older than 10 years old. So this budget, I'll put $20,000 in it for that. To get a full set of turnout gear, pants, boots, coats, helmets, gloves, the whole nine yards, you're looking, you know, an estimate of $3,000 per guy. So hopefully if the budget goes through, the $20,000 will get me, you know, roughly 10 set of them, and I have 35 guys on the roster. There's several sets that need to be replaced. Another cost that's been incurred by the fire department is replacing our 800 megahertz radios throughout the county. The ones that the county bought years ago, the 2500 series, is becoming phased out and obsolete, and you can't get parts for them, you can't buy them anymore. So we're starting to purchase small amount of radios along the way. These portable radios is costing anywhere from $3,000 to $4,000 a piece. So you can only get 3 or 4 at a time each year. So we're trying to replace that inventory and just doing what we can each year. As far as the turnout gear is concerned, the 800 radios, the truck that we're purchasing, is replacing the 1988 model truck, which is 28 years old. And also increasing the benefits for our pay staff, health insurance, workman's comp, maintenance on the stuff, repairs on equipment. And I don't know if there's any truth to it, more expense might be coming to the fire department because the fire marshal's office has indicated that they might stop some of their services that provide to the fire department. As far as our pump desk is concerned, our lighter desk, and that, you know, we have to pay for, if they stop doing those, we might be cost of that. So that's some expenses, and that's why I'm asking for an increase for 11 cents. I'll entertain any questions y'all may have.
So you're replacing a truck, is that you will be when you get this?
Yes, sir. It's a 1988 model.
You said before, 465.
The new one's going to cost $569. Hopefully, it takes about a year to build a truck. And then talking to the credit unions and stuff, they'll be late payments for a year. So hopefully I'll have 2 years worth of putting roughly $80,000 back. And hopefully by the time we take delivery of the truck, I can put down a down payment of about $160,000. So that will be financing right at $400,000.
Are you able to sell the whole vehicle?
Yeah, we're going to try. But it probably won't generate, if 20,000 on the high end, it's a huge debt. It's all.
Thank you.
Grove. President Grove is requesting an increase of 2 cents. The increase is for several items we are planning. First, we have a loan for the new engine we've also ordered. The new engine equipment will cost approximately $480,000. We are going to be replacing a 1975 model truck. And part of the other cost we are incurring is with fewer volunteers to run EMS and fire calls during the day, we are currently right now using part-time employees. We want to hire a full-time employee as well as keep part-time employees. So that will be an increase in cost. Third is we are in the process of trying to build a substation because part of our district, 5 mile district covers what your insurance rate is, and at this moment, Pleasant Grove is a 7 on our ISO rate. By building this new station, we will bring in the northeastern part of the district that's not covered by fire under the district. We will bring them into a 7 once this is completed, and in our estimates right now, we will be saving the homeowners over $102,000 per year for their premiums if we get them to a fire district rate, ISO rate of 7. Right now, at this time, those homeowners are paying the fire tax, and they are not receiving the benefits of the lower cost premiums. Our fourth thing is with, like Jimmy was talking about earlier, with OSHA and National Fire Protection Association standards changing, we have got to replace out some of our turnout gear. Luckily, in 2009, we received a grant to replace, so we're looking at 2019, a large percentage of our turnout gear will have to be replaced, so we're looking forward now to go ahead and replace now 4 to 5 sets of turnout per year, and I'll continue to work on grants to try to help that out, but that's not a guarantee. The SCBAs that we use have also increased. They used to be $3,500. They are now $6,000, and as Jimmy stated, we went from paying $800 for radios to paying $3,000 and $4,000 for radios, so that's increase of 40%. Also, in line with the fire engine, the last fire engine we bought, which was 13 years ago, cost $290,000, so now we're looking at $460,000. We tried to get into where we replaced the engine every 10 years, but because of cost restraint and trying to hold the line, we're at year 13 right now. And it's kind of a broken down line by line item. As far as I think y'all may have on the personnel, probably pretty much reiterating what I said, we're looking at trying to hire a full-time employee and keep the full part-time employees we have so we can keep a more coverage base on the community. Operations has increased because of SCBAs and radios. Also, we're looking at, the county is talking about possibly stopping the maintenance program on the radio system, so that'll be some cost we're going to have to incur ourselves. And as Jimmy spoke, unfortunately, the Fire Marshal Service may have to cut back some of the services they do for us, which they're a great group, and we would like to encourage any help you can give those folks also. But we will have to incur costs to pay for our own pump tests and ladder testing, as well as any other kind of testing that Fire Marshal does, and they're right now they're in a personnel issue with getting the air truck out to us, so there may be something that can occur. If we do have to go to getting our own type of air system, you're talking about $8,000 or $9,000, it's something we can't really do right now. So we're gonna try to work with Fire Marshals on that. Also, we are gonna have to increase the capital outlay as part of this to pay for it. Equipment that has to be put on fire trucks. Stuff that used to be $50 now is $500 and $600. Our capital reserve, as you see in our line items, I think I've seen our capital reserve. Once we make a note for the down payment on this fire truck, we will reduce it by over 50%. That's all I have for the commissioners. Anything you need to ask him, glad to answer.
Where will you use substation?
Intersection of Davisville Road and 119. We have already, the board has already seen the foresight to go ahead and purchase the land. We dealt with, you know where Duke Forest is, this
purchasing that land, so we went ahead and went forward with that purchase.
Who's covering that now?
It's still us covering it. It's just the citizens, because of the way the ISO rates, it only goes 5 miles out from the station. They're still paying the county tax, the fire district tax, and that we're still covering them all the way to Cali County.
Change your rate and bill on it.
Yes. Yeah, we've met with Mr. Vernon Ward, who is the ISO from the state. And he is the one that strategically helped us place where the station needs to go. And we get it built and the proper equipment in, which is two engine and a tanker. Excuse me, I'm not used to public. And we get airplane checked out within 120 days. Well, that district will automatically go to a 7. And by doing that, we're hoping in the future to lower our fire rate, I mean our ISO, to maybe 5 or 6 through water supply.
Any complaints from your district?
None to my knowledge, no, sir.
Anybody else?
We are an 8.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you. God bless you.
And North Central.
My name is Joe Chandler. I'm the chief of North Central. Appreciate you letting me talk to you tonight. Just wanted to give you a little insight. Our proposed budget for 2016-17 is $137,783. That being because we are one of the smaller districts, the smallest district in the county. So we're asking for 11.5-cent tax rate for our district. That would be a 1-cent increase. And 1 cent increase means $12,329 to us. So, you know, it's a big help to us, but it's not a huge amount. It's been 9 years since we last had an increase. We increased from 9.5 cents to 10.5 cents 9 years ago. Several years back, we started a new truck fund, trying to prepare for the future and get ready for our next purchase. We kind of see it coming. But as of present, the new truck fund balance is just $17,987. We've had to cut funding to our new truck savings when station expenditures have risen over the years. With this additional funding, we will be able to set aside $18,096 for the coming year with 1 cent increase. We would like to pay as much down as possible when purchasing a truck to avoid paying interest on the debt as we have in the past. In the long run, we feel this would be a substantial savings to the station and to the taxpayers in our district. At present, our frontline engine, one we're using first one out of truck, is 21 years old. It still serves us well. We have a tanker second out that's 29 years old. And we aren't ready to replace them just yet. We do feel we need to be planning for the future. And paying for replacement on these things and trying to build a fund up for it. In 2015, we improved our insurance rating from a 7 rating to a 6 rating. These benefits the property owners in our fire district by lowering their homeowners' insurance premiums. For our station to maintain this level of service, we must maintain the equipment that is allowed to do the job on call time. Be happy to field any questions.
Do you have any from your district about raising the taxes too?
No.
I did talk to one of your board members, I think Bill Carey, and said one of y'all's problems, you don't have any industry out there.
No, it isn't. So very little business out there. Yeah. It's all residential and farmlands.
This is in the recommended budget.
Yes.
Very good. Thank you. Thank all the chiefs for coming and speaking.
So, in the motion, is that, do we need to clarify that, or that?
What we do, we can use either portion, all of undesignated, half. You tell us what you want to use, what we'd like.
Well, I would like to suggest that we use all undesignated fund balance, all, because I don't think that our staff is going to be able to use everything that they say, because we're not going to need financial specialists for that to happen. But I think it's important that we still maintain some level of incentives for our staff to save money, because we're getting into that situation where, if all goes well, probably by this time next year, we're going to be looking at an even fund balance, or that actually that, what is it, 21 million in fund balance, will still be 21 million even though we're budgeting.
Clear now.
Okay. Very good.
All right. For other business tonight, we have ADSS request for bond proceeds.
Good evening, Chairman Osborne, County Commissioners. I bring for you today a request for $120,158 to use out of our bond money that's left to put a few more projects this summer for our shows.
So moved.
That leaves about $168,000
yes,
spent, so we're getting down to, you know, and it needs to be closed out. It does, it's a 05 bond.
That's what
so it does need to be closed out. So we are working on getting that fund level. Where
I'm seeing a lot of work that's going on right now in schools while they're out.
Right.
This, we thought we'd go a few more things.
Very good.
I got it.
Yes, sir.
Recently, we information from the person who was at Williams High School and found some problems, like in the restrooms and different areas like that. Is my is the assumption here that that's already being taken care of with other monies?
This is kind of a split thing. We've got 10,000 additional extra dollars for auditorium repairs, plus we already had money allocated from lottery to do some gold replacement and to do some minor revisions in the restrooms. At this point, it's going to take a major renovation to create more toiletry space, but we are going to do some renovations to try to improve the facilities.
I think
space
was
issue
in that.
That's been addressed.
Very good. We have a motion and a second. All in favor of approving this?
Aye.
No opposition. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All right. Property liability insurance renewal. You defer to Ron.
When I spoke to you at the budget workshop, you were laying in words of going with Strapler's Insurance Company through our current carrier, Hub International. They did come back with a very, very good deal. We were staying within under $28,000 in the budget, reducing our deductibles down to feeling right. And we're asking your permission tonight to go ahead and find this coverage for the 16th century fiscal year.
I haven't seen any downsides or downsides.
No, they're offering a lot of good incentive partners for us to use for our discretion with employees. So there's no downside to it as far as
so, so that said, it's already budgeted and
you know? It is not. What we have done is we have created a self-insured property liability insurance, so we would maintain the $527,000 that's already budgeted, and then that would add to the fund balance there. So if we had a big claim there, then the county would be responsible for there's sufficient funds there without having to come back to the general fund.
So moved.
Second.
All right, thank you.
And I do want to thank Rhonda for the work that she's done on this, and Rhonda and Clyde have done an exceptional job of making sure that this part, we're basically self-insured as far as our liability, but I appreciate what Rhonda's done.
I have to defer to Mr. Albright, and he is forced to be recognized with our claims.
Very good. All right, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposition? Hearing none. Pass. All right. DSS budget.
Good evening. So this is just shoring up the budget changes we get throughout the year at social services. So it's a flat amount in revenue and a flat amount in expenditures. And you can see the different line items. We got some extra Smart Start money. We're able to put some more kids in child care. And we pay it right out. So it all balances.
So moved. All right, thank you, David. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposition? Okay. Budget amendment for the sheriff.
These are your cars.
Cars
And
the equipment.
Yeah.
Oh,
just asking the commissioner, of course. I just need to make you aware that we're looking at buying four cars out of drug seized monies this year, not budget next year. And by doing that, it is not surplanning the budget. If I wait until this budget is passed to bring this before you, then it's surplanning the budget. And I love all of you, but I'm not going to jail for it.
Questions? What are you asking for?
To be able to buy cars out of those airports. I know that, but
for this pot of money, we did. We have to let the board be aware.
Folks make the board aware, we could have possibly done it by letter or something like that, but talking with our county manager based on pulling two cars out of next year's budget by here. To come before you, like aware.
Buying them out of drug seized money, right?
Yes, sir.
There's no tax money.
No, sir.
I make a motion.
Yeah.
All right. I'm in favor. Aye. Opposition. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Now we have public comments here.
Well, Mr. Parks, yes, sir.
Yes, we just went right on by that. We need to get a motion to set a public hearing on July 18th for CS Carolina for economic incentives. And I'm guessing Mac will do the presentation.
He will. At this time, we're working with them on some numbers and some job figures. They weren't ready, but they were ready to move forward with the timing of the public hearing.
Okay. We will not have the first July meeting.
We will, yes, sir. We've already canceled the July 4th meeting. Yes, sir.
Okay. So moved. All right. Second, Roger. Thank you, sir. All in favor? Aye. Public comments. Christopher Tate. I think you're in our audience somewhere, and I'd like to welcome you down.
Good evening, commissioners, and thank you for having me back for. I think this is my sixth time presenting this invitation. Thank you for having me. This invitation, you may well remember, is the annual invitation to the Alamance County Amateur Radio Club's annual Field Day of Operation. Field Day this year will take place on Saturday, June 25th and Sunday, June 26th. The event will start at 2 p.m., continue through the overnight to 2 p.m. on Sunday. This year, we're fortunate enough to be welcome back to the Alamance County Emergency Operations Center on Martin Street in Burlington. The folks at the Fire Marshal's Office, I have to put in a good word about them. They've let us use their facility the last several years for some of our equipment, and we are very grateful for them allowing us to use their space. And frankly, we're very excited because we have air conditioning. The public, of course, is also invited to come out and discover what amateur radio operators can do for the public in emergencies. Field Day is principally an emergency preparedness exercise. The goal of this Field Day event is to contact as many other participating stations in the state, around the country, and even around the planet as possible within the 24-hour period. By the rules of Field Day that might have been handed down on stone tablets a couple years ago or more, we have to set up and operate portable stations using emergency power to simulate what would happen if a real disaster were to affect the area. We send and receive messages very quickly and efficiently as if it's really, Field Day is just a simulation of what we would do should a disaster like a hurricane, a tornado outbreak, an earthquake strike the area. It's an opportunity for amateur radio operators, of course, to meet the public and discover all that amateur radio has to offer. We always love to get new people into the hobby. We have really something for everybody. You can make friends all around the globe. I have friends in the United Kingdom. I've never met them in person, but we communicate on a semi-regular basis. Just, hey, how you doing? Also, you get to learn about new places. I spoke just to a German working at a research station on Antarctica. You don't get to do that every day. Amateur radio truly has limitless possibilities, and it's a great time for both government officials and the public to learn about not only the usefulness, but the fun of amateur radio. Once again, field day, amateur radio field day, Saturday, June 25th, Sunday, June 26th, 24 hours starting at 2 p.m. at the Alamance County EOC. We look forward to your attendance, and to the public, come on out. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris.
Christopher is an excellent pianist as well.
Oh, okay. Very good. I've seen you grow up at these meetings.
Yeah.
Coming back. Very good. Anyone else have anything you want to speak about in public comment?
As I said a while ago, there's been accusation after accusation after accusation. And maybe it's time for some accountability. I've not heard one hearing discussing what brought about different things. Two with the plumbing licensing board. Thursday and Friday, I went to their meetings in Greensboro. And then this deal with the town's news right here. Those are strong accusations. Very strong. Especially in this climate. Everybody knows that I'm not about that. And I think there should be some accountability here. I would ask for that. I've said it for a long time now. Those types of meetings. Transparency. If you make the accusations, stay behind. We know that Bowman did. Let's see what's on this other. Because for me, Guns N' Roses, Civil War, it starts out. What we have here is a legacy communicator. Cool man. It's always been a fun thing. But if they go out there and they stay away, they've been having a civil war out there for years.
All right. Anyone else? Not commissioners? Comments? Commission for me? I do want to thank our staff. I want to thank all the commissioners for working very hard to put our budget together. And I think we've put some good work into this, and I think we'll see the results of that. So thank you, staff.
I'd like to say I'm just my second month, and I really appreciate what goes into building the budget. You know, I did that privately, so it's tough. It's a cost center, and you only have so much money, and it's hard to make everyone pleased with what we do. But we do a show.
Participation very much.
I'd like to say thanks to several speakers who came up. I thought their points were excellent, particularly those points about the need to build this foundation for our future through education while also recognizing the intricacies of all the county government departments and functions that go into building our community strong, including public safety. And it all has to work together. It's all part of that rope that Tracy was mentioning. And every strand of that rope needs to be strong. We're not the strongest community. And it is very difficult to balance everything. And so we'll go through this year with this budget and see what we can do next year.
Any other comments? Now I'll take a motion to adjourn. All in favor? Aye.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.